Good evening to all. So today's topic in respiratory system will be about the general physical examination of the respiratory system. So like we discussed in general examination of abdomen, the RS general examination is also divided into three parts. Practically any general examination will be divided into three parts: head to foot examination, anthropometry, and vital signs. So the head to foot examination will consist of a few other points, starting from general appearance, posture, stance, and gait, nutrition and hydration status and edema, skin, eyes, face, neck, chest, hands, nails, lymph nodes, feet, and some special consideration for the particular system. So if this is followed, we may not miss many things. So in respiratory system, a few things are relevant. Like in skin examination, like usual, we look for pallor, ichthus, cyanosis, scar swellings and lesions. Eyes, we have to look specifically for subconjunctival edema, because a facial edema with subconjunctival edema may point towards an SVC obstruction. The same thing is given in the next point also. Face, you should specifically look for edema or plethora to look for a SVC obstruction. In neck, we have to look for a thyroid swelling or a tracheal tuck. I'll discuss the importance of that later. In chest, we have to look for gynecomastia. Gynecomastia and respiratory system has two important points. A patient with bronchial asthma or COPD taking chronic steroids and develop gynecomastia due to Cushing's, etc. Similarly, ACTH producing small cell lung cancers can produce gynecomastia. In hands, what are the things you have to see? We can look for fine tremors, which includes salbutamol toxicity. So any patient in bronchial asthma COPD patient who is chronically taking inhaled beta agonist, either by nebulization or first will have fine tremor. The same patient, if he is having flaps or close tremors, it indicates respiratory failure due to flapping tremor or hypercapnia. Small muscle wasting, that is due to T1 involvement, can signify T1 nerve root involvement in pancreas tumor or upper lobe involvement. In nails, as usual, we look for clubbing, pallor, cyanosis. The color of the nail is important in respiratory system because there is a syndrome called as yellow nail syndrome, which has a specific association with bronchiectasis. Similarly, nicotine stains. Nicotine stains can be looked for both in the nails as well as in the oral cavity. And lymph nodes are important. And a few special points to look for in respiratory system will be, for any patient with respiratory complaints, look for tuberculosis, look for honors. Again, starting from general appearance till the special consideration, we will discuss each. Ideally, the examination should be done with the patient in a relaxed position, in 45-degree resting position, head supported by the pillow. May not be possible all the time if the patient is breathless. So, we'll see one by one. So, when the patient comes into the OP, just by seeing the patient, a few things can be obvious. The first thing we always look for is the consciousness level. A respiratory patient whose consciousness level is decreasing may be due to a CO2 narcosis or lung cancer, which has metastasized to the brain, causing reduced consciousness level. The next point which we look is if the patient is comfortable or is distressed. I haven't used the word dyspnea here because dyspnea is as such a subjective sensation of the patient. So if the patient is comfortable or distressed. If the patient is speaking and not able to complete a sentence, is using accessory muscles of respiration, which includes sternocleidomastoid, trapezius, scalenus, flaring of ala nasa, is in a rare distress. Intercostal indrawing and subcostal indrawing signifies respiratory distress. A COPD patient has a special type of breathing called as pursed lip breathing. I'll show the image later. It signifies severe COPD. And any patient who is coming itself with a noise, an inspiratory noise, inspiratory noise is strider, expiratory noise will be an audible wheeze. The patient with an audible wheeze or an audible strider indicates he is in severe respiratory distress. So these 5 points, just on looking at the patient, we can say that he is in respiratory distress. Hoarseness of voice is important because like laryngeal tuberculosis can cause a hoarseness of voice. So a patient with hoarse voice for the past few days, who is complaining of some respiratory symptom. It could be a primary pulmonary tuberculosis, which has spread to the larynx also. And always in respiratory system, have a look at the surroundings, because inhalers, speculum meters, sputum pot, oxygen mask can give a clue that is a respiratory patient. So this is what I was telling. In this patient, he has a special type of breathing called as a pursed-lip breathing. He exhales by pursing his lips. You can see there is a central cyanosis. The lips are cyanosed in them. And there's an edema in this patient. It is actually a case of COPD. Due to exacerbation, he is having a pursed-lip breathing. Due to hypoxia, he is having cyanosis. Since COPD is one of the conditions which is prone to cause carpal nail, there's a periorbital edema in this patient. So it's actually COPD carpal renal presenting with exacerbation. Does the facial look and give a diagnosis? So next to the general appearance, have a special look at their posture. A patient with acute COPD exacerbation will be sitting forward with arms placed on the table like this. He may hold on to the table, or if no table is available, he may hold on to his knees. So why this is? In COPD, when he is in respiratory distress, we need the support of all extra muscles apart from the diaphragm to expand his chest. So when the patient is sitting forward with arms held in the table, the pectoralis major muscles go into a comfortable position so that they can pull the ribs outward to help in chest expansion. This position is specifically called as the tripod position. The same position can be adopted by a patient, by any patient who is in respiratory distress, be it a respiratory cause, be it a pulmonary cause. So even a pulmonary edema patient will be brought to you with between a stretcher, he'll be sitting forward, he'll be holding on to the table. But one difference is, since COPD is a chronic disease, due to chronic tripod position, the area of the knees may have some contusion, that is called as ball sign. A patient with pneumonia, one-sided pneumonia and one-sided pleuritis and pleural effusion will be comfortable and lying down to the side of the lesion. In history, we call this as tripopnea. But in examination, whenever a patient is comfortable, whenever lying to the particular side, we call it as autospring. Because one of the characteristic features of a pleuritic pain is the pain will be more in the lateral axillary region. Pain will be more in deep inspiration. And it will be relieved on lying to the same side. So lying to the same side will give us some kind of splinting effect to reduce the pain. So pleuritis, the patient will be lying to one side. Whereas in COPD exacerbation, patient will be leaning forward in a tripod position. So this is what I was telling. COPD, even bronchial asthma, pulmonary edema, whatever be the cause of respiratory distress, the patient will be in tripod position. So after general appearance, after the posture and stance of the patient, look for the nutrition status of the patient. We know very well any patient with malignancy or tuberculosis will be malnourished. So like we discussed in abdomen, the word malnourishment is actually a loosely applied term. So how to confirm the patient is actually malnourished? Look for the body mass index. Look for other objective signs like tricep skin thickness, skin fold thickness, etc. And any patient with obesity, especially central obesity and neck obesity, that is male pattern obesity, they are more prone for obstructive sleep apnea, which is again one condition which causes both systemic hypertension and pulmonary hypertension. Again, Cushingoid habitus, I told you, chronic steroid use can cause Cushingoid habitus, and paraneoplastic, ACTH producing tumors can be a paraneoplastic manifestation producing a Cushingoid habitus. So whenever you look for a nutrition status, always look for an edema in the patient. Bilateral edema in respiratory patient, think of carpal nail. So that is the relevance of asking swelling of legs and reduced urine output in a patient with respiratory system. Any carpal nail, presence of carpal nail, always think of pre-respiratory diseases which are commonly associated. It could be a COPD, which is the most common respiratory disease causing carpal nail. The second being interstitial lung disease, third being bronchiectasis. Similarly, a unilateral edema, patient with unilateral edema who presents with breathlessness, think of pulmonary hypertension. The thing here is, both these conditions cause an elevated JVP. In carpal nail, due to chronic pulmonary hypertension, there will be an elevated JVP. In deep vein thrombosis and acute pulmonary embolism, we have something called as acute carpal nail. There will be elevated JVP. Okay, so after this general survey, we go system by system. Skin can give a clue. Murray and Nadal gives a term called as pulmonary cutaneous syndrome. Even Fishman gives a term called as pulmonary cutaneous syndrome. Many lung diseases can manifest primarily first in the skin, followed by respiratory manifestations. I'm not giving the complete list here, just a few points. A distinct swelling in the skin may be a metastatic nodule in lung cancer. Erythema nodosum in skin can point towards a sarcoidosis, TB, histoplasmosis, or coccidiomycosis. Presence of a skin abscess with respiratory complaint, the skin abscess could be a source of a lung abscess. Similarly, in IV drug abuses, that could be the source of a lung abscess and even an infective endocarditis. We have a special entity called as pulmonary cutaneous syndrome, pulmonary renal syndromes. The very well-known vaginous granulomatosis, Sturge-Strauss syndrome, microscopic polyangiitis, and Goodpasture syndrome. These four diseases, commonly we label it as pulmonary renal syndromes because they present with glomerulonephritis with some RS manifestation like hemoptysis or asthma like that. So they present with vasculitis. And few paraneoplastic skin manifestations include acanthosis nigricans, pemphigoid, polymyositis, dermatomyositis like picture and Raynaud's phenomenon. And atopic dermatitis in the skin, the flexural eczema, black discoloration of the eyelid, all these are signs of atopic dermatitis. Presence of these can point towards a bronchial asthma. This scenario will be given very well in a pediatrics textbook, OPI. Any child who is coming with black color of eyelid, always ask for history of bronchial asthma. It's like a spot diagnosis. Similarly, what I was telling, dalsing. Due to chronic tripod posturing in a COPD patient, just above the knee joint, there will be contusion and abrasions. It's called as dalsing. So this is a picture from MacLeod. This is a metastatic skin nodule in a lung cancer patient. This is an erythema nodosum. Erythema means redness. You can see the redness. And there's a node here specifically. So this is an erythema nodosum. Occurs in sarcoidosis, tuberculosis, coccidiomycosis, and paracoccidiomycosis. So after the skin, look at the face. So these points I have discussed already. Just look at the finding. We have a facial edema. We have edema in the neck. There's a plethora of the face. And there's a dilated SVC. Due to SVC obstruction, there is a dilated collateral CA. So it's a clear-cut case of SVC obstruction. We can see there's a gynecomastia in this patient. So probably the patient would be having an upper lobe small cell lung cancer, which is causing gynecomastia as a paraneoplastic manifestation, as well as it's causing an SVC obstruction. So next, we have to look for a thyroid swelling or a tracheal tuck. Tracheal tuck has no relation to respiratory system as such, but this has been described in textbooks along with respiratory system. That's why I mentioned here. Tracheal tuck is also called as Oliver's sign. This point was asked in last week's PG summit. The systolic downward movement of trachea in aortic aneurysm is called as tracheal tuck. So after we have finished the general survey, the skin and face examination, a few things which can be seen in the lips, in the face, in the nails is pallor, icterosinosis, clubbing and clubbing. Sorry. So pallor in respiratory disease can signify a hemoptysis. A chronic hemoptysis can cause iron deficiency and even cause pyelonychia. Excessive sputum production causing protein loss. Remember, any hypoalbuminemia will cause hyponychia. And alopecia even loss of appetite can cause pallor. The patient will not take any intake, cause iron deficiency and pallor. In pulmonary disease, it could be a pulmonary infarction. A patient with tuberculosis started an ATT and developed drug-induced liver injury and can develop icterus. And a liver cirrhosis, liver secondaries in the primary lung cancer, there can be icterus. So, two important physical examination findings which are pertinent to the respiratory system will be cyanosis and clubbing. So, I'll be discussing them in detail. Cyanosis, as we know, is the bluish discoloration of the skin and mucous membrane that is caused by an increased amounts of reduced hemoglobin in the subcapillary venous plexus. The specific amount given is more than 5 g/cl. Or cyanosis can occur even due to abnormal pigments in blood, that is hemoglobin more than 1.3 g/cl or a sulf hemoglobin more than 0.5%. I told you, reduced hemoglobin more than 5 g/cl only will cause cyanosis. in our body for a person to survive, only maximum 50 to 60% of the hemoglobin can be a reduced hemoglobin. So if the patient is having a severe anemia, hemoglobin is less than 8, we can have a maximum of reduced hemoglobin up to only 4 g/cl. So it cannot pass cyanosis. So even though the patient is cyanosed, cyanosis signifies intra-arterial hypoxemia. So even though the patient is having intra-arterial hypoxemia, in an anemic patient, cyanosis cannot be made out. Another condition where the patient is cyanosed actually, but it's not manifested, is carbon monoxide poisoning. So cyanosis can be a central cyanosis or peripheral cyanosis. This question is very often asked, how to differentiate between central cyanosis and peripheral cyanosis. Very often we say cyanosis of the skin and mucous membranes, that is tongue slips is involved, it is central cyanosis. Only the skin and nails are involved, it is peripheral cyanosis. But that's not the actual answer. We have actually 6 points. Central cyanosis is due to intra-arterial hypoxia, whereas peripheral is due to diminished blood flow to the local part. And the point which we all know, the lips, tongue, skin and mucous membrane is involved, it is central cyanosis. Only the peripheries is involved, it is a peripheral cyanosis. In central cyanosis, due to intra-arterial hypoxia, there will be peripheries will be warm. It has nothing to do with perfusion. Whereas peripheral cyanosis is due to a reduced perfusion, so we have cold extremities. Central cyanosis, since it's a long-standing process due to intra-arterial hypoxia, hypoxia is a stimulus for clubbing. And hypoxia is a stimulus for hemoglobin production. So clubbing and polycythemia are associated with central cyanosis, where they are not associated with peripheral cyanosis. If they ask you any test, any maneuver you can do to prove central or peripheral cyanosis, we can dip the patient's arm in warm water, because local heat abolishes peripheral cyanosis, whereas local heat does not abolish central cyanosis. Similarly, the opposite, giving pure oxygen can reverse arterial hypoxia and cyanosis decreases in central cyanosis, whereas cyanosis persists because it's a perfusion disorder in peripheral cyanosis. So in short, central cyanosis is due to a oxygenation defect, whereas peripheral cyanosis is due to a perfusion defect. Something which increases perfusion, like an exercise or a local heat, abolishes peripheral cyanosis, whereas something which abolishes, which improves oxygenation, like giving 100% oxygen, may improve central cyanosis. Again, I'm telling, may improve central cyanosis. As we know, in respiratory disease, it's not a perfusion disorder, it is a arterial hypoxic disorder. So we have only a central cyanosis. Like I showed in the first picture, the patient had a lip cyanosed with the closed lip breathing. It was a case of COPD. Interstitial lung disease can present with cyanosis on exertion. The word exertion is important in respiratory disease, because you'll be comfortable with rest. Just make the patient walk for a few minutes and then do the examination again. All the findings will be manifested now. So cyanosis on exertion, they are given specifically for interstitial lung disease, and alveolar hypoventilation, obstructive sleep apnea, etc., can cause central cyanosis. So this is the thing which we have here. The patient is having a club knee. We can see a cyanosis here in the nails. There's a polycythemic mixture in his tongue, which is cyanosed, and he's in oxygen. So probably he may be a case of COPD. So next to cyanosis, we have the next important respiratory, next important general examination finding, which is clubbing. Clubbing is a fascinating finding. Many textbooks give different description of clubbing. So I consulted it from everything. Clubbing is defined as the bulbous enlargement of the soft tissues of the distal segments of the digits. It takes minimum of 2 to 3 weeks for clubbing to manifest. So clubbing first appears in the index finger. Why clubbing is important is, clubbing is seen in about 1% of hospital admissions. But the presence of clubbing means 40% of the time they'll have some serious diagnosis associated, be it a malignancy or some suppurative lung disease or an interstitial lung disease. So as you know, clubbing has 5 grades. Some say only 4 grades. The phase one is fluctuation of the subbundle bed. So that when Am I audible? Hello?
In the slide start or the third first one
the clubbing phase one then
the starting
so clubbing is classified into five phases. The first phase is when the soft tissues increase, it increases the gap between the nail bed and the nail. So we have something called as a fluctuation. That is the first phase. The second phase is we have a diamond shaped space which we can see. That is the normal distal phalanx, and the nail make an angle called as a Lowy bond angle, which is actually 165 degrees or something, it is 15 degrees. This angle is lost. So loss of Lowy bond angle is the second step. Phase three is convexity starts appearing. Fourth phase is we call it as drumstick appearance. So increased convexity, we call it as a parrot beak appearance. And when parrot beak appearance continues further, we call it as a drumstick appearance. Phase five is called as hypertrophic osteoarthropathy. That is, apart from the nail changes, there will be bone changes also. Not only the digital changes, even up to the wrist and elbow also can show changes. So these are the five phases. So the first phase, what happens is there will be increased soft tissue deposition, which lifts the nail and causing a fluctuation which occurs. That is the first phase. And the second phase is the loss of Lowy bond angle. What they say is, compared to fluctuation, loss of Lowy bond angle is the most sensitive indicator of clubbing. But very often this phase is missed. But where we pick up most often is the phase three, where there is increased convexity of the nail bed, which we call as parrot beak appearance. Fourth phase is the drumstick appearance, and fifth phase is hypertrophic osteoarthropathy. One point which is not given in textbooks, but which was discussed in PG summit, was patient with congenital cyanotic heart disease, since they are having this phenomenon from childhood, there'll be an uniform enlargement of the nail. So drumstick appearance is more characteristic of a congenital cardiac disease, whereas a parrot beak appearance means some process has just now started. So it's an acquired disease. So most of the diseases present with parrot beak appearance, whereas the congenital cyanotic heart disease characteristically presents with the drumstick appearance. So these things we know. Look for fluctuation, look for the Shamroth window. So a few theories have been told. Commonly what is accepted is, any patient with chronic hypoxia is a stimulus for vascular endothelial growth factor. More of vascular endothelial growth factor causes subfungal proliferation of capillaries and venous blood veins to cause clubbing. Another theory is, any lung disease or liver disease, a few metabolites will not be destroyed in lung and liver. So they bypass the circulation, they go to the peripheral tissues and cause clubbing there. They cause proliferation and clubbing there. So that is the reason why most of the lung disease cause clubbing. And even a cirrhosis with portal hypertension can cause clubbing because of this factor. So that is what is called as the humoral theory. A neurogenic theory is, vagotomy abolishes clubbing. That's why they told vagal involvement has some role to play in clubbing. And other theories is, some say ferritin is a cause of clubbing. And PDGF theory is one recently accepted theory. So there are, this table is taken from Fisher's Pulmonary Medicine. There are 9 respiratory causes of clubbing. Primary lung cancer is given as the first cause. Bronchiectasis, cystic fibrosis, lung abscess, pulmonary fibrosis, pulmonary AV malformation, empyema, mesothelioma, and neurogenic diaphragmatic tumors. For ease of understanding, we can classify into a few headings. Tumors of the lung and clubbing, it could be a primary lung cancer, mesothelioma, or a diaphragmatic tumor. Suppurative lung diseases and clubbing, bronchiectasis, empyema, lung abscess. And others, we have pulmonary fibrosis and pulmonary AV malformation and cystic fibrosis. One important thing to note is, clubbing does not occur in COPD. It's a rule of thumb. So any patient with chronic history of smoking, generally they say, any patient with a crack year of more than 20 for 10 years, they are more prone for developing lung cancer. So any patient with history of smoking who is a known case of COPD, he presents with clubbing, never stop with the examination, always look for a cancer. So do all investigations necessary for ruling out a cancer. So grade 5 clubbing, which is hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, is more specific for lung cancer, cystic fibrosis, suppurative lung disease. Even it can occur in tuberculosis. So if they ask you the question, causes of tubby in respiratory system, please mention these 9 points. If they ask you hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, mention these 3 points: lung cancer, cystic fibrosis, and subperiodontal lung disease. So I told you hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, apart from clubbing, there'll be tenderness of the wrist and ankles, and there'll be subperiostal newborn formation. We can even do an X-ray to confirm the finding. So whenever the question is asked in the exam about clubbing, next question goes towards what is differential clubbing, what is unilateral clubbing, what is unidistal clubbing. I'm not mentioning everything. Unidistal clubbing has some local cause. For example, a local trauma, local AV malformation. Unilateral clubbing, the unilateral disease is hemiplegia. So any patient with hemiplegia, that can be unilateral clubbing. Specifically in respiratory system, the answer will be a transverse unit. Because a unilateral obstruction of the SVC, there can be unilateral clubbing. Differential clubbing is a serious question. I'm not discussing it. So this list and table is taken from Murray and Nadal's respiratory medicine. The thing is, they are given so much of diseases and they have mentioned it as a partial list. So I told you clubbing is a fascinating entity. There are so many causes. Just we have discussed a few important parts. So next to cyanosis and clubbing, lymph node examination is again very important in respiratory system, because looking at the lymph node itself can point towards a tuberculosis or a malignancy. So this is lymphatic drainage of the chest. Every lung drains into the drains through the clavicle, it drains into the cervical lymph node. So we had to do a cervical lymph node examination. We had to do a scalene lymph node examination. Scalene lymph node is the lymph node which is seen beneath the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So we had to relax the sternocleidomastoid muscle and we had to palpate for the scalene node. And even we can look for the supraclavicular lymph node. So these are three groups of lymph nodes basically associated with the respiratory system. Again, I'm not discussing the detail. So we just started with the general appearance of the patient, what to look for in the posture of the patient, and a few specific features in the face, in the eyes, in the nails, and in the neck of the patient, and about the nutrition status of the patient, and a few paraneoplastic skin markers. And after that, I told you there are two special entities to look for in respiratory system. One is look for external markers of tuberculosis and look for Horner syndrome. So what are the external markers of tuberculosis? The tinea versicula, clictonular conjunctivitis or keratitis. Even we can do a fundus examination for TB nodules. Lupus vulgaris in the skin, erythema nodosum, which I showed you. Scrofuloderma, which is lymph node examination with ulceration in the neck. And epididymo orchitis and thickened spermatic cord. Even though when there is no epididymo orchitis, palpate spermatic cord, a thickened spermatic cord points towards a tuberculosis. And Horner syndrome is very important because any lesion, be it a tumor, be it an abscess, be it a consolidation in the upper lobe, will obstruct the sympathetic nerve outflow to the eyes and it will cause a Horner syndrome. So classically, remember the mnemonic sample, a sympathetic nerve injury will cause anhidrosis, meiosis, unilateral partial ptosis, loss of ciliospinal reflex and anophthalmos. Classically, these 5 findings are the one which is described in Horner syndrome. So this is what is given in this patient. That's a ptosis. When you lift his eyelid, we can see a meiosis. And there'll be an anophthalmosis and unilateral anhidrosis. This is the classical Horner syndrome. When I appeared for my UG final year examination, my examiner straight away asked, what are the 8 features of Horner syndrome? At that time, I couldn't answer. But last year, when I was referring another book, this is the photo taken from Paul Brace's localization of clinical neurology. They are given 12 points for Horner syndrome. Literally, they are one and the same. Ipsilateral ptosis. Upper lip ptosis is associated with the lower lip ptosis also. That's called as upside down ptosis. That's an anophthalmosis. Whenever we say meiosis, obviously, there will be an anisocoria and there will be a dilator lab. So that has been given as 2 points. And there will be increased accommodative amplitude or an accommodative paresis and transient ocular hypotony. And facial anhidrosis, ipsilateral, and there are a few points given specifically for a congenital or a hereditary Horner syndrome, that is ipsilateral straighter, heterochromia iris, neurotropic corneal endothelial failure, and ipsilateral nasal obstruction. So if someone asks in fourth what are the features of Horner syndrome, we can mention 8 points, and there'll be 4 points again specific for hereditary Horner syndrome. And the first link is going to be over. I'll stop here. I'll create a new link and we'll join.
பத்து நிமிஷம் இருக்க
இல்ல ஒரு நிமிஷம் தான் இருக்கு.
சரி ஓகே.
Okay, I have finished the head to foot examination. I'm not discussing anthropometry yet, the things which we know only, body mass index, skin fold thickness, and few other measurements are there. It will be discussed in further classes, which comes in inspection and palpation of the respiratory system. So there's nothing specific as a measurement in respiratory system. So coming to the vital signs, the importance of pulse in respiratory system. A bounding pulse indicates CO2 retention because carbon dioxide is a vasodilator. So because of vasodilatation, patient will be having a bounding pulse. Similarly, pulse pressure will be narrow in massy hemoptysis due to shock. Blood pressure, that's one special character which has to be noted. Apart from seeing blood pressure, it is a pulses paradoxes. Pulses paradoxes is actually a normal phenomenon. Normally with inspiration, there will be fallen systolic blood pressure. But it will be less than 10 millimeters of mercury. But if the inspiratory fall of systolic blood pressure is more than 10 millimeters of mercury, we call it as a pulses paradox. So it's actually an exaggeration of a normal physiological phenomenon. In respiratory system, an acute exacerbation of COPD or an acute exacerbation of bronchial asthma causes pulses paradoxes. So why there's a fall in BP is the patient is taking an excess inspiratory effort. That is what is the meaning here. So it is an ominous sign, pulses paradox. So the vital sign, we have finished pulse, BP. Now they're about the respiration. It's not the respiratory rate which is the vital. We have to look for the respiration as a whole. So four things you have to look for in respiration. One is the respiratory rate, the type of respiration, pattern of respiration, and look for any paradoxical respiration. So respiratory rate. In the respiratory system chapter in Hutchison, they are given the rate as 12 to 16 per minute. But in another place, they are given the rate as 14 to 18 per minute. But most of the textbooks stick with the normal rate of 12 to 16 per minute. So I have given it here. If the rate is increased from 15 to 20 breaths per minute, we do not call it as a tachypnea. They call it as a normal physiological variant. A patient with anxiety can have 15 to 20 breaths per minute. But respiratory rate more than 20 is called tachypnea. So this point has been incorporated in many of the COVID management guidelines. Any respiratory rate more than 20 is called as tachypnea. As we all know, it is different from dyspnea. Never in your examination mention patient is dyspneic because dyspnea is always a subjective finding. Only when the patient says I am dyspneic, we call it as a dyspnea. But the few objective things to say whether the patient is dyspneic or not is one which we have mentioned in the general examination. A patient who is sitting forward in a tripod position means he is in respiratory distress. A patient is speaking, he is not able to complete sentences. He is using accessory muscles of respiration. There is flaring of ALA and ASA. There's intercostal indrawing. All these points point towards that the patient may be having a dyspnea. But never label the patient as dyspnea in your examination finding. We can mention tachypnea. Bradypnea, respiratory rate less than 12 is called as bradypnea. Apnea, we all know, cessation of the respiration for at least 10 seconds is called as apnea. So apnea is a characteristic feature of obstructive sleep apnea. And it is used in grading also. More than 12 apnea episodes in 1 hour is taken as mild. More than 30 in 1 hour is taken to be significant, like that. So apnea can be a central apnea or an obstructive sleep apnea. Obstructive apnea, actually, even though there is a respiratory effort, the patient cannot breathe. That is obstructive apnea. Central apnea, there is a loss of central respiratory drive for breathing. So type of respiration, it could be abdominal thoracic, thoracoabdominal, purely thoracic, purely abdominal. Normal respiration, you know, diaphragm is the prime muscle of respiration. So in normal respiration, both abdomen moves outward and the chest wall moves outward. But abdomen movement is more relevant and prominent than the thoracic movement. That is called as abdominal thoracic respiration. Most of the normal adults, both males and females, have abdominal thoracic respiration. Thoracoabdominal respiration, the same thing. Both chest wall and both abdomen moves outwards with respiration, but the thoracic movement is more than that of abdominal respiration. even in females, abdominal thoracic is normal, but few females have thoracoabdominal respiration because of their increased abdominal fat content. Pregnancy, the breathing will be thoracoabdominal because abdominal movement will be restricted because of the fetus. A purely thoracic respiration, that is, the abdomen is not moving, only the thoracic moving, is could be due to a diaphragmatic, pure diaphragmatic paralysis, peritonitis or ascites. You know, peritonitis, the abdomen will be a board-like abdomen with the rigidity, so abdomen will not move. Similarly, in ascitic patient, the diaphragm will be in uncomfortable position to contract. The ascites will be pushing the diaphragm upwards, so diaphragm cannot contract. So thorax will be the prime muscle. A purely abdominal breathing, again, the opposite of this one. There will be a lung disease, so our lung is, chest is not moving, abdomen is moving purely, a pleuritis or a lung collapse. Another interesting finding is we can diagnose a cervical cord lesion even with the type of pain. Assume there's a spinal cord injury at the level of C6. Now C3, C4, C5 will be spared. So diaphragm will be normal. So there'll be abdominal, inspiratory abdominal movement during inspiration. But since the thoracic intercostal muscles are lost due to C6 level injury, now the thorax will not move. So purely abdominal breathing can also occur with the in patient with cauda paresis when the lesion is below the level of C5 spinal cord. Remember, in upper cord lesions, both the diaphragm will be paralytic as well as the respiratory muscles will be paralytic. That's why they may go for intubation. Upper cord lesions, it is patient has to be monitored because they go for both diaphragmatic paralysis and the chest muscle paralysis. So they may need intubation or a positive pressure ventilation. What I mentioned here in thoracic type of respiration is a diaphragmatic paralysis. So in most of the cases, when the diaphragm goes for paralysis, obviously the chest muscles also go for a paralysis in high cord lesions. But in lesions below C6 spinal cord, we have a pure abdominal respiration. I have not mentioned here. That's why I'm explaining. The type of respiration could be abdominal thoracic, thoracoabdominal, purely thoracic, or purely abdominal. Purely thoracic in abdominal disease, purely abdominal respiratory disease. And pattern of respiration, I have put it as a separate slide. What is paradoxical respiration? I told you both abdomen and chest moves outward and equally during inspiration. Paradoxical respiration is during inspiration, if the chest wall or abdomen moves inwards, it is called as a paradoxical respiration. Assume a patient with COPD has a hyperinflated lung. Now the diaphragm has been pushed downwards and is flat. Now the diaphragm cannot pull the ribs outward because the diaphragmatic anatomy has been changed. So what happens is the diaphragm contracts from outside to inwards. So instead of pulling the rib outward, it will be pulling the rib inward. That is the basis of a sign called as Hoover sign, which we see in COPD. So a patient with COPD, there will be inspiratory indrawing of the subcostal space, which is called as Hoover sign, also called as paradoxical respiration. Not only in COPD, any condition which causes embarrassment of the diaphragm, we can have paradoxical respiration. So in inspiration, if the diaphragm is going inward, we call it as a paradoxical inspiration. So since the diaphragmatic anatomy has been changed, the abdomen also will not move out. The abdomen will still keep moving outward. So in inspiration, chest wall will come inside, but the abdomen will be moving outside. That's called as a thoracoabdominal asynchrony. So next time, whenever we are seeing a patient, especially in an emergency, to say whether they are in distress, look where the chest wall moves during inspiration. If it is moving inward, it's called paradoxical respiration. And if the chest wall is moving in, but the abdomen is moving out, we call it as a thoracoabdominal asynchrony. These two parameters have been described in Chang's ventilatory, Chang's textbook of ventilation, that the patient is going for respiratory failure, you have to change the existing mode of ventilation. So these are the three causes of paradoxical breathing. One is a flail chest. Fracture of three consecutive ribs is called as flail chest. Since the rib is broken, the existing anatomy is gone. During inspiration, the chest wall will move inside. And I told you the paralysis of the diaphragm or embarrassment of the diaphragm will cause paradoxical respiration. Similarly, any respiratory failure can cause paradoxical breathing. In emergency medicine, always look for a type of breathing. This is very important. So we discussed the importance of rate. We have discussed the importance of type of respiration. We have discussed about paradoxical respiration. Now, few points about the special types of respiration. So this is what we discussed. Normal respiration will be regular, comfortable at the rate of 12 to 20 per minute. Textbooks say 12 to 16, but up to 20 is taken to be normal. Less than 12 is called as bradypnea. More than 20 is called as tachypnea. There is a tachypnea with increase in the depth of breathing. We call it as a hyperventilation. some textbooks say even Kussmaul's breathing is a type of hyperventilation. So increase in the rate, increase in the depth of breathing is called as a hyperventilation or a Kussmaul's breathing. We get it in metabolic disorders. Sighing is a normal breath with a frequently interspersed deeper breath is called as a sighing. This picture is taken from Murray and Nadal, so the highest textbook of respiratory medicine. Air trapping, where there's increased in getting the breath out. So they inspire normally, but their expiration gets prolonged. Chain strokes breathing, which I've been learning since first year, there is a intermittent period of increase in the rate and increase in the depth of the breathing, followed by reduce in the rate and reduce in the depth of breathing, followed by period of apnea. The cycle repeats. All the clinical medicine textbooks in respiratory system, they are discussed in detail only about chain strokes breathing. Because chain strokes breathing is the type of breathing which has multiple causes. But when we discuss a few types of breathing, such as Baryat's breathing or an ataxic breathing, it goes mostly into a neurological cause. Baryat's breathing is also is an irregularly interspersed periods of apnea in a disorganized sequence of variable breath. Ataxic is a significant disorganization with irregular and varying depths of inspiration. Both Baryat's and ataxic, some say it is equal, but the definition, there's a slight difference. A significant Baryat's breathing is called as an ataxic breathing. The significant neurotic disease, I'll tell you later. So chain strokes breathing, I told you, it could be normal, it could be abnormal, and it occurs in multiple diseases. Chain strokes breathing could be normal in a patient who is sleeping, in a healthy adult in altitude, and in elderly diseases. But chain strokes breathing can occur in any severely ill patient, in severe heart failure, narcotic drug poisoning, and in some neurological disease also, which I'll tell in the next slide. One word which you have to describe is, it is due to abnormal feedback from the carotid chemoreceptors to the respiratory center. I'm not discussing it in detail. In short, if you have to say, there is a hypoxia, but the signal that there's a hypoxia goes to the brain late. So there's a late onset of hyperpnea, which corrects the hypoxia. Again, the signal gets conveyed to the brain later. So there's a period of apnea shortly. So it's an abnormal feedback from the carotid chemoreceptors to the respiratory center. So these are the causes of chain strokes breathing. We commonly do not mention chain strokes breathing in our patient because the patient calls us, attenders call that the patient is breathing abnormally, but when we go to them, they breathe normally. Probably it could be due to chain strokes breathing. So what are the neurological causes of abnormal breathing patterns? So this slide mentions a few respiratory causes of abnormal breathing, mainly tachypnea, bradypnea, or chain strokes breathing. But neurological causes also, we have to be important because any patient who is an intubated due to a stroke will have abnormal breathing. We always wonder what it would be. Chain strokes breathing, this is what I was mentioning. A progressive increase in rate, increase in depth of breathing, followed by reduce in depth and reduce in rate of breathing with the period of apnea. Cycle gets repeated. The disease could be due to bilateral cortical lesion. So a bilateral cerebral cortical lesion causes a chain strokes breathing. A midbrain lesion causes hyperventilation. An upper pontine lesion causes apneustic breathing. Apneustic breathing is, they inspire normally, but the breath gets held up in inspiration. Similarly, when we go to the lower pons and to the medulla, the breathing becomes more or less irregular. So we get a Baryat's breathing or a ataxic breathing. So neurological causes, any bilateral cortical lesion will cause chain strokes breathing. Midbrain lesion will cause a hyperventilation. Upper pons will cause an apneustic breathing. Lower pons will cause a Baryat's breathing or a, and a pure medullary lesion will cause a respiratory arrest because it is the one which contains Bolzinger complex which is needed for generating the respiratory rate. Okay, so we have finished pulse, we have finished blood pressure, we have finished respiration. Temperature is the fourth vital. Its use is obvious. Any acute infections will be elevated. Now coming for the fifth vital, which is JVP. Whenever there's an JVP elevation, look whether it is pulsatile or non-pulsatile. A non-pulsatile elevation in JVP, it could be due to SVC obstruction, the image which I showed you. Pulsatile elevation could be due to a carpal nail. I told you carpal nail can occur in the chronic setting or the associated pulmonary hypertension. The three common lung diseases are COPD, interstitial lung disease, and bronchic cases. Acute carpal nail, there will not be features of pulmonary hypertension, but there will be right ventricular failure and elevated JVP, where we get in two diseases, tension pneumothorax and large pulmonary embolism. A patient who is breathless, we cannot see JV. Because a relaxed sternocleidomastoid mastoid is essential for a JV. So the fifth vital, fusate is JVP, a fusate is a pulse oximetry. So this is the guy who invented the pulse oximeter. He is not a doctor, he is a bioengineer. He is Mr. Ayogi. So pulse oximetry, we should see both in rest as well as in exertion. I mentioned this word already again because the patient may be comfortable at rest, but just making the patient walk for a few minutes will bring about this underlying respiratory disease. So we have finished head to foot examination, we have finished anthropometry, we have finished vitals and its significance in the respiratory system. Now, before proper examination of the respiratory system, which consists of inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation, never start respiratory examination without examining the upper respiratory tract. Most of the infections of the lower respiratory tract have a source in the upper respiratory tract, and most of the diseases of the lower respiratory tract can be diagnosed from the upper respiratory tract. Lower respiratory tract starts from the below the larynx. So, proper ENT examination is needed. For example, in the nose, you have to look for elevated nasal septum, nasal position, mucosal hyperemia, etc. But specifically look for nasal polyps because four diseases are associated with nasal polyps. Vaginous granulomatosis. One of the criteria to say vaginous granulomatosis or granulomatous polyangiitis is the presence of nasal symptoms. A patient is having a cavitary lesion in the lung, always look for the nose for a nasal polyp because that indicates a vaginous granulomatosis. Similarly, an asthmatic patient may have a nasal polyp, or we call it as a Samter's triad. Bronchial asthma, nasal polyp, aspirin hypersensitivity, we call it a Samter's triad. Allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis and cystic fibrosis also can cause nasal polyps. Look for sinus tenderness because from the sinus patient may have a continuous source of infection, which gets aspirated. Look for the oral hygiene. That could be the source of a chronic microaspiration and a lung abscess. Look for dental caries. Again, that could be the source of a lung abscess. Look for a bitten tongue. In a seizure patient would have bitten the tongue, there will be bleeding continuously. That would be aspirated and that may cause aspiration pneumonia. So oral hygiene, dental caries, bitten tongue, all these can be the source of a lung abscess. In cardiovascular system, again, the same thing should be looked for because that could be the source of an infective endocarditis and lung abscess could be associated with infective endocarditis. Look for the tonsils. Again, tonsillitis could be present. If the tonsil is enlarged along with an enlarged uvula, that means the patient is having a gastroesophageal reflex. We call it as Quincke's disease. So, an edematous uvula means a gastroesophageal reflex that could be the source of an aspiration pneumonitis again. So post-nasal drip, any upper respiratory tract infection, there'll be mucus pillage, which can be seen. That's called as post-nasal drip. This is one of the causes of nocturnal cough. And oral candidiasis, think of use of inhaled corticosteroids. So the stigmata of use of inhaled corticosteroids, look for oral candidiasis, look for itching and habitus. So this is about the examination of the respiratory tract. So in the next two classes, we'll be discussing about the respiratory system examination in detail. Other system examination also should be looked for. I'm not discussing the relevance of each because we have so many things to look for, so many things to answer in other system examination. Just a few points is musculoskeletal system is important because SLE can cause lung manifestation like in the form of interstitial lung disease. Rheumatoid arthritis can cause rheumatoid nodules. Ankylosing spondylitis is a form of respiratory restrictive lung disease. So always look for musculoskeletal system in connected in respiratory system because that could be the source of a lung disease. Look for cardiovascular system because one of the terminal endpoints of a respiratory disease will be pulmonary hypertension and corpulmonary. So cardiovascular system is important in that aspect. Cardiovascular system is again important because the respiratory diseases and cardiovascular diseases present with nearly the same companies. Because breathlessness, chest pain, and cough. These are common to both cardiovascular system and respiratory system. So only a proper examination will guide to decide whether it is a respiratory disease or a pulmonary disease. Very often in the primary care setting, a pure cardiac disease, like an ongoing pulmonary edema will be wrongly diagnosed as a case of bronchial asthma exacerbation and will be treated with nebulizer. Remember I told you, nebulizer will cause tachycardia, tremors, and giving injection terephthalate and tachycardia, which can precipitate respiratory failure. So always cardiovascular system is important to rule out whether the cause of the breathlessness is a respiratory disease or pulmonary disease, and to rule out the end stage of pulmonary disease, pulmonary hypertension or pulmonary. When I was in UG, I was taught that the onset of pulmonary hypertension and respiratory disease is the beginning of the end of the patient. And always look for the abdomen, because the patient's complaint can be entirely due to the abdomen. And ascites, I told you, can push the diaphragm above and cause a, it can cause a diaphragmatic embarrassment. And it could be the cause of patient's distress. So just tapping the ascites can relieve symptoms. Similarly, a case of right-sided pleural effusion, look for ascites. Or we call it as a hepatic hydrotherapy. A left-sided pleural effusion, always look at the abdomen for a pancreatitis. Another case of right-sided pleural effusion is look for an ovarian teratoma. Again, it's an abdomen examination. This is again important because hepatic hydrotherapy, treating the lung will not treat the disease. So if the patient is having ascites and he's having a hydrothorax, putting an ICD can relieve the pleural effusion. But we know very well that abdomen is a positive pressure chamber. Chest is a negative pressure chamber. So the negative pressure will keep on pulling the fluid from the abdomen and hydrothorax will persist. So that is the, so these are a few important points why we should look for the other systems. So specifically look for the musculoskeletal system, cardiovascular system and abdomen. So these are my references. I have put specifically Murray and Nadal's textbook last because Murray is a person who was 80 years old. He contributed to this book, great textbook of respiratory medicine. He contributed to most important points, relevant points about ARDS. And lastly, due to the COVID pandemic, he died due to COVID. So stay safe, even though you don't stay home. Thank you.
Sir? Sir,
yes.
Two doubts, sir.
Hmm.
Sir, and the pulsatile JVP, non-pulsatile JVP, sir.
இப்ப நீ நார்மலி ஜேவிபிக்கும் அரோட்டிக் பல்ஸ்க்கும் டிஃபரன்ஸ் பார்க்கும்போது ஜேவிபில டபுள் பல்ஸா வரும் அரோட்டிக் பல்ஸ் சிங்கிள் பல்ஸா வரும் படிச்சிருக்கோம் இல்லையா இப்ப நார்மல் ஜேவிபி வில் பி ஹேவிங் சம் வேவ் ஃபார்ம்ஸ் எக்ஸ் அண்ட் ஒய் டிசன்ட் அப்படின்னு சொல்றோம்ல நார்மல் ஜேவிபி வில் ஆல்வேஸ் ஹேவ் சம் வேவ் ஃபார்ம்ஸ் வேவ் ஃபார்ம்ஸ் இல்லாம ஒன்லி இன்டர்னல் ஜூகுலார் வெயின் இஸ் டைலேட்டட் அது எப்பவுமே டைலேட்டடா இருக்கு அந்த வேவ் ஃபார்ம்ஸ் தெரியலாம் இட்ஸ் கால்ட் அஸ் நான் பல்ஸ் If the waves of JVP is visible, it is called as pulsatile JVP elevation. If the waves is not visible, it is called as non-pulsatile JVP elevation. In abstract, you have a pressure wave on the right atrium and the IJV go ahead. That meaning. Non-pulsatile elevation indicates always some obstruction.
Okay, sir.
Sir,
usual non-pulsatile, na, we'll see only the external jugular vein, no, sir. அதுதானே நம்ம நல்லா டைலேட்டடா ஒரு கர்லிங்கான ஒரு வெயின் பாப்போம்
அந்த வெயின் தான் பாப்போம்
ஐஜேவி will not be usually visible no sir ஈஜேவி will be visible it's we as a superior vena cava obstruction la ஈஜேவி தான் non pulsatile jvp na do you mean about the ejv or ijv sir
it means ijv தான் readily visible is ejv readily visible is ejv na the obvious namak theriyum the facial plethora la irukumbodhu namak ejv dhaan velila
theriyum
but jvp also
facial plethora yeah okay sir
ijv also will be elevated
okay sir
செகண்ட் வந்து அந்த கிளப்பிங்ல வந்து அது லெஸ் தென் 5% கீழ இருந்தா பேலன்ஸ் தெரியாது சம்திங் ஐ யூஸ் அது ஏதோ சொன்னீங்க சார் அந்த பாயிண்ட் வந்து எப்படி கண்டுபிடிப்பீங்க எனக்கு தெரியல
இல்ல கிளப்பிங் ஃபேஸஸ்ல ஃபேஸ் 1 வி கால் இட் அஸ் இன்கிரீஸ் ஃப்ளக்சுவேஷன் தான சாஃப்ட் டிஷ்யூஸ் கெட் அக்யுமுலேட்டட் அண்டர் தி நெயில் பெட் சோ ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஸ்டெப் வந்து நம்ம ஃப்ளக்சுவேஷன் பாக்கும் அதாவது டிப் ஆஃப் தி நெயில் அழுத்தும் போது வந்து ப்ராக்ஸிமல் பார்ட் ஆஃப் தி நெயில் வில் எலிவேட் நார்மலி இட் எலிவேட்ஸ் பட் இஃப் இட் எலிவேட்ஸ் மோர் வி கால் இட் அஸ் ஃப்ளக்சுவேஷன் செகண்ட் என்னன்னா நீ நார்மல் நெயில் பார்த்தன்னா டிஸ்டல் ஃபலாங்ஸ்க்கும் ப்ராக்சிமல் பார்ட் ஆஃப் த நெயிலுக்கும் நடுவில் ஒரு ஆங்கிள் இருக்கு சரியா அது ஆக்சுவல் ஆங்கிள் வந்து 165 degrees வி கால் இட் அஸ் லோவி பண்றாங்க இப்போ கிளப்பிங்ல என்ன ஆகும்னா ப்ராக்சிமல் பார்ட் ஆஃப் த டிஷ்யூஸ் தானே எலிவேட் ஆகும் அதனால இந்த ஆங்கிள் வந்து ஆப்லிட்ரேட் ஆகும் ஸோ நெயிலே வந்து ஸ்ட்ரெயிட் ஆகும் இப்போ இங்க நீ பார்த்தானே தெரியும் டிஸ்டல் ஃபலாங்ஸும் நெயிலும் கண்டினியூஸா ஒரே லைன்ல இருக்கு இட் இஸ் கால்ட் அஸ் லாஸ் ஆஃப் லோவி பாண்ட் ஆங்கிள் நீ இந்த ஆங்கிள் ஆக்சுவலி கால்குலேட் பண்ணா ஒரு அப்யூஸ் ஆங்கிள் தான் வரும் 165 degrees ஆங்கிள் தான் வரும் சில பேர் என்னன்னா இந்த நெயில் நெயில் போன் இருக்குல்ல நெயில இருந்து ஸ்ட்ரெயிட்டா ஒரு லைன் வரைஞ்சிட்டு அதுக்கப்புறம் நிகழ ஒரு லைன் போட்டா 15 degrees சொல்லுவாங்க அதனாலதான் சில புக்ஸ்ல என்னன்னா 15 degrees ஆங்கிள்ஸ் நார்மல் லோவி பாண்ட் ஆங்கிள் கொடுத்துருப்பாங்க, சில புக்ஸ்ல வந்து 165 degree ஆங்கிள்னு போட்டிருப்பாங்க. அப்ப கன்ஃபியூஸ் ஆக வேண்டாம், ஒரு வேல்யூ ஞாபகம் வச்சுக்கணும்னா நார்மல் நெயில் மேக்ஸ் அன் ஆங்கிள் ஆஃப் 165 degree வித் டிஸ்டல் ஃபாலன்ஸ், இட் இஸ் த நார்மல் லோவி பாண்ட் ஆங்கிள். That angle is lost. அதான் இந்த அந்த ஒரு சின்ன பெண்ட் இஃப் இட் இஸ் லாஸ்ட் இட்ஸ் கால்ட் அஸ் லாஸ் ஆஃப் லோவி பாண்ட் ஆங்கிள். இட் இஸ் டெஸ்டட் பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஷாப்ரோட்ஸ் விண்டோ சைன். இட் இஸ் த செகண்ட் சைன் அண்ட் இட் இஸ் த மோஸ்ட் சென்சிட்டிவ் சைன் ஃபார் கிளப்பிங்.
மேல வந்து தெரியும் சார்.
இப்ப ஐ டோல்ட் யூ மோர் தென் 50% ஆஃப் ஹீமோகுளோபின் இஸ் சச்சுரேட்டட்ல, சோ ஹீமோகுளோபின் 10க்கு மேல இருந்தாதான் உனக்கு ரெடியூஸ் ஹீமோகுளோபின் 5க்கு மேல இருக்க முடியும். சோ வென் தி ஹீமோகுளோபின் இஸ் மோர் தென் 10 இருந்தாதான் வி ஹேவ் வி கேன் சீ சைனோசிஸ் கிளினிக்கலி. அப்படினா எனி அனிமியா சிவியர் அனிமியா புக்ல போட்டுருக்கு, பட் பிராக்டிகலி அனிமியா இருந்துச்சுனால நமக்கு தெரியாது. ஹீமோகுளோபின் மோர் தென் 10 இருந்தாதான் நமக்கு சைனோசிஸ் தெரியும் பை டெஃபினிஷன்.
ஓகே சார், தேங்க்ஸ் சார்.
ஓகே
பம்ஸ்.
ஆ சொல்லுங்க சார்.
நீங்க அந்த 9 தானா அந்த ஸ்லைடு மட்டும் காமி.
இது ஃபிஷ்மேன்ல இருந்து எடுத்தது,
இதுல கிடையவே கிடையாது,
இதுல அந்த பாயிண்டும் போடல. இப்போ டீடைல் லிஸ்ட்னா இது வந்து முறையா நடால எடுத்து இதுலயே கொடுக்கல.
ஓகே,
நான் பாத்துக்கேன். சோ மேபி வேற ஏதும் காசா இருக்கு இருக்குறது. பட் ஹிஸ்டரி கேட்கும் போது வந்து சின்ன வயசுல இருந்து இருக்கு, என் அப்பாவுக்கும் இருக்கு அப்படின்னு காட்டினாங்க. அவங்க அப்பாவுக்கும் அப்பாவுக்கும் இருந்தது எக்ஸாமின் பண்ணுங்க. சோ இப்படிய கண்டென்ட் கிளப். ஓகே ஓகே, தேங்க் யூ.
தேங்க்
யூ.